Were you good at playing the game then? Because it is a game, isn't it? The media. It is a game, getting on here and me getting you and you not wanting to do it or me wanting you to do it.
No, I mean, absolutely right. You know, it's and of course it's become an ever increasingly important game because everything's about image. Whether you're a star or a multinational company or a political party or the royal family, image is very important to your success. So I was extremely lucky just to stumble into a career that has become increasingly, shall we say, influential and therefore beneficial.
We've got a ton of people to talk about tonight. Mm-hmm. Let's start with the Beatles, because I think that's the thing that most of our listeners will be curious about. Firstly, in the days when you were working with them, did you know they were going to be as big as they are now, even?
No, I mean, you just knew that this was amazing. You know, we were all about the same age in the press office. Sid was a lot older. He was into the jazz and Sarah Vaughan and Ella Fitzgerald and people, so he wasn't that interested. The marketing director of EMI took me to one side and said to me, Max, you know, don't spend too much time on this lot, son. They've got no chance. But we loved their music and we loved their energy. And you know, personally, particularly, I was, you know, a big John Lennon fan, because he was the driving force to me. He was the heart and soul of the Beatles, and I loved his sense of humour and the fact he said it as he saw it, you know.
I spoke to a lot of people over the years, and I'm going to put this diplomatically. Ricky Tomlinson, for example, said that they weren't necessarily the best band in Liverpool. I mean, how did you feel about their talent? Because a lot of people have said that they weren't necessarily the best, but well, they just had a certain charisma.
Of course, that's a matter of taste, but look at the songs. One song after another, number one, all over the world. I mean, my goodness, if they weren't, then, you know, I'd like to know anybody that was any better. There was a lot of very great talent around, just emerging. It was all very raw. At EMI at that time, we were launching the career of Adam Faith and Cliff Richard. 3 or 4 years later, we launched Tamla Motown, an incredibly exciting time. But out of all those great talents, for me, they stood out.
What were they like as people in those days? I mean, did they get carried away with it? I'm curious to know, as an ugly man, what it must have been like being the most sexy guys in the world.
Well, I mean, obviously for them, it was staggering. I remember we flew into America for the very first time. And of course, there's thousands of kids at the airport. And George Harrison, who I was sitting next to, leant across and said, my goodness, there must be somebody famous coming in. Look at them. Genuinely not realizing that they were there to see them. So for me, it was an incredible adventure that I was just very, very lucky to tap into. My part in their success was non-existent, but they helped me tremendously, because everybody in the world that needed to make contact and find out what was going on had to come through the EMI press office. So we built up tremendous contacts from day one.
Was it as important then to get on the radio and to get the press releases and get in the showbiz columns as it is now? Was it? Can you compare it at all?
It's totally different. You know, early days, and if you knew 12, 13 people, 14 people in the media, you had the whole country covered. You know, on the national press, the same guy did showbiz, as music, as theatre, as entertainment, as rest. Now they've got loads of different people. So it was a much simpler process, a much gentler, much nicer process. People were much, much nicer in those days. Journalists, some of them are actually quite nice people. and they weren't even cynical then. So it's all changed tremendously. But I was just fortunate because, you know, when we were learning, there was a lot of much friendlier, much nicer people around, and you kind of learnt as you went along with them.
When you were a PR man in those days, how easy was it to help people like the Beatles? Did they want your help, or did they think they were doing their bit and you were almost hassling them?
No, I mean, I think, you know, they were very easy to work with. And I stress this was in the very early days, because as they took off worldwide, so they had their own team of people and we had less and less involvement. But for the first year or two, we worked closely with them, myself and everybody in the EMI press office. And they were lovely to work with. You know, they were having a wonderful time. You couldn't believe what was happening. But again, at the same time, there were loads of other people at EMI that were also enjoying huge success.
How well were they treated by you guys? I mean, today you get the penthouse suites, you get the private planes. Were they treated as well in those days?
No, not in the very beginning, no. I mean, this is a system that's built up over the years. It was all very much in its infancy, and they did okay, but nothing compared to today. I mean, when you have the kind of success that they had. But of course, after a year or two, you know, they're having huge success everywhere in the world, and of course, everything, you know, the riches that followed.
Yesterday, we were celebrating the life of John Lennon, who would have been 65 yesterday.
Yeah.
And I'm just curious, did you get to know him? What was he like? What was he like to work with?
No, I mean, you know, we have our own stories, but you didn't really get to know them because so much was happening so quickly. And obviously they were busy conquering the world and we were busy launching not just them, but loads of other people at the same time. But I mean, John to me was the leader. You know, he was the one that was really the driving force. Him, Paul, incredibly talented. George, shy. Ringo was just Ringo. But he was always my favourite. And I suppose also I liked the fact that he didn't suffer fools gladly, that, you know, he knew when they were giving him rubbish and, you know, when someone said, oh, I always believed in you, and he said, that's just rubbish. A year ago, you didn't want to know us, you know, and to me, that was a breath of fresh air.
Where were you the day John died?
I don't remember. You know, I just, obviously things had moved on an awful lot. And by that time I was kind of busy traveling all over the world, looking after all kinds of stars and companies and doing PR for, you know, the kind of some of the people I represent now. I mean, the Sinatras came along, the Muhammad Ali's, Brando's, all these people. So, you know, it was a kind of, they were a tremendous help to me in the early stages. But then the busier I got, and I was out on my own, obviously building a business, building a career. So, you know, the quicker time just flashed by. So I honestly don't remember. But, you know, I remember obviously feeling, you know, the tragedy of someone so comparatively young and so talented, and thinking what a terrible waste from someone who just wanted to be famous. And I was the guy that shot him. Tragedy.
Will there ever be another Beatles? Will there ever be another phenomenon as big as the Beatles?
Well, of course, you can never say never, Alex, but you can't see it because it was a totally different age. Everything was just emerging. And when you think of the success they had worldwide, you know, record after record after record, album after album, you can't ever imagine. I mean, today it's a hugely successful, sophisticated business. Then it was very raw, incredibly exciting. And I mean, I can't imagine you can ever achieve anything like that again, because it's a different age now.
What's your favourite Beatles song?
Well, I suppose I think back of Love Me Do with great affection, because of course it was the beginning, and when we first heard it, we thought wonderful, and most of the people at EMI were saying, oh yes, so much for that.